if I was there already. Of course. In suburbia, sure, I was there. I was there. But you know, the funny thing here is that even I have to think very hard to even remotely remember what exactly happened. You see, I wasn't there in the very beginning, of course. But to simplify, wherever Alistair went, I went. You know, I knew from the start that I'd remember Alistair. Much like I'd always remember Karen. And Karen was out, or so I thought. But as much as I tried, she was always in there somewhere hiding, you know? And then she'd pop up when I least expected it, you know, with her sexy fucking Swedish accent. She was there as well. Of course she was there. Why wouldn't she? Once upon a time, somewhere in suburbia.
Violence. It's a fascinating thing once you're introduced to it. I often compare it to that one lay that each man should experience at least once in his life. And, as with that, fantasy takes you a long way. You'll watch porn, peek inappropriately at the beach or the pool house when you get a chance, always making sure you're very careful, not allowing anyone to notice just how truly strong your obsession is. And as with that one lay, that one woman, violence will make you utter the urge among those unaware of your hunger. You'll hint in conversations how your fascination towards her is growing, how it's emerging from fantasy towards acts of reality, all the while making sure they think you're joking. As with that one perfect lay, violence takes a whole new grip once you're introduced to it in person. Once you finally get her into bed and feed that hunger to its full extent, at that point, there's no going back. But with violence, of course, the difference is that people die. Kid, I walk up to you, I look like this, a complete menace, and your reaction is... What's wrong with you?
What do you want from me, Alistair?
That's not the... Wait, you know me?
Everyone knows you, Alistair. You made quite a name for yourself.
Kid was right. People do know me. And don't worry, I wasn't out to harm him or anything. It was all part of my research. How does one react in the actual situation? The whole speech about violence and having sex with women? Well, that's the reason I'm so well known. My name is Alistair Burnham. I'm a traveling writer of short stories. And as for that earlier stuff, if any of you thought you had some kind of revelation through it, I'd like to point out that it's from my story, Duncan's Call, published in Horror Weekly's Christmas issue from last year. It's all nonsense. Hell, how would I know about women and violence? I've barely even been in a relationship. But hey, that's the beauty of it. No one knows. They just read it and believe.
I swear to God, I didn't do it. You know me, I wouldn't do it.
I want to believe you, I really do, but I just can't make sense of all the rumors.
Look, she's a good friend of Monica's and she was having a tough time. You weren't reachable as usual, so she reached out to me. It's all that happened, I swear on my life. What was that?
I guess there was something that I should admit, though. I really haven't been able to write anything for quite a while now. When my first short story was published 5 years ago, I'd been working on the rewrites for 8 months. The story itself, before the magazine demanded rewrites, had taken me nearly a year to finish. Without sugarcoating it, I was, and still am, a ridiculously slow writer. In fact, I'm so slow that after having published 3 stories, I had to take a trip, a long journey to find inspiration. My head was a clean slate. I was desperate. I started doing this, taking long journeys, constantly traveling and doing practical research into violence and fear, in order to grasp the concepts of my stories. But about a year ago, my inspiration, the very core of it, just died. More words would emerge, not in my head, and most definitely not on the page. So that's when, 8 months ago, while living in Montreal, I noticed a gift. A gift so powerful, so unexplainable, that revealing it to anyone could ruin my entire career. What is it? It's simple, but unnatural. In fact, let me put it this way. When I said that stories just come to me, I was talking quite literally. Sometimes it would take several weeks, sometimes even a month, but eventually, words would always appear.
Is your shoulder strap too tight and annoying? Introducing the Tiddy Bear. That's T-I-D-D-Y Bear. The cute little guy that eliminates all those irritating shoulder strap problems.
How did you get in?
The door was open.
The door was not open. How did you get in?
I used the ladder out front.
True. Pause that.
Your game has been paused.
You want me to leave?
No, but this has to end. If you don't like being home alone, it's cool. But you gotta tell me first. You can't just barge in like that. Parents off working again?
No. Holiday on Jamaica.
They left you here?
Yeah. I'm sorry.
Don't worry about that. Like I said, you just let me know and it's cool. I'm gonna go get a pizza.
Why do you want shrimp on your pizzas?
Because it's good. I like it.
It's not good.
You know, I would break your teeth if I find any pizza stains in that jersey.
Oh, relax. How much do you want for it anyway?
It's not for sale, Drew.
Well, can I borrow it?
Yeah. Just for tonight. I want it back before you go home. If I could keep it.
What, really?
Yeah, all right. Will you be okay from now?
What?
I got a date.
I thought you said you broke up with that girl.
What girl?
The one with the loud chewing noises.
Her. Yes. It's another girl. I promise you head home to your place, not my place. All right? And stop breaking into my apartment.
I will have to start writing things by myself at some point again. Because my only explanation is that it's God sending me a message so that even though I get stuck every once in a while, He will get me through it. But some days He won't stop. Stop supporting me, stop writing my words for me. But until then, I have to keep this to myself. I haven't even had the gut to send these to the publishers. What would you do with the words of God?
Oh, thank you. So, buddy, how's it going?
What, the writing?
Yeah, or you know, this whole search for inspiration you got going on.
I don't know. I mean, I'm just gonna wait and see where the story takes me, I think.
Why don't you seek inspiration elsewhere? You know, like, other kinds of inspiration. You could, like, fall in love. Or you could go on a trip. You could take a trip to what's it called? Napalm. Nepal. Anyway, point being, anything but this. All right, and then eventually you could maybe write something that does not revolve around violence.
No, I know what I have to do.
Yeah, I guess you do. You see, I myself, I'm not a big fan of horror stories. I prefer comedies. But I did see this one film once. It was about this cannibal, and he was traveling all over the place. He was trying to find people he could eat. It was a good one. Can't really wrap my head around why he had to eat all those people. Anyway, back to what matters.
What?
Oh, come on, Alistair, Halloween night. I told you I had something planned.
With the girl...
Kiki, yeah, that's her name. And you know, Kiki, she's finally looking at me. And tonight, we've been invited exclusively to entertain her and her cousin.
Yeah, it sounds fantastic.
And by the way, tonight, there's no talk about your short stories or your ongoing writer's block or your blah, 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 because nobody cares. And tonight is about being normal for once. All right. Why, look at that. That's so funny. Holy shit, we gotta get going, man.
Perkins. Thanks, Frank.
Mr. Hilton. Yes, he was spotted this morning at the deli in the center of suburbia. We're here now with the town officer. We don't know, because they barely have any police here. I have to work with a woman. Well, I have to go now. I'll call you later.
The waitress heard them talking about a Halloween gathering of some kind.
What is that?
What is what? Halloween?
Yes.
Are you serious?
Yes.
It doesn't matter. But get this. A young boy said a bearded man approached him with a baseball bat yesterday.
Volmer?
No. It wasn't Volmer. Guess who?
Well, who?
The boy identified the man as Alistair Burnham.
The writer?
Exactly.
But Alistair Burnham was in Halstead at the same time we spotted Volmer there.
Exactly.
You don't think they know each other, do you?
Could be a coincidence, but it's worth looking into.
And where is Alistair Burnham now?
So, I told her that we at least stay until midnight, right? And hopefully, when you hit it off with the cousin, you two are gonna bounce, right? Kiki and I will stay at the house and...
What?
Matters. Wait, why the hell do you have a bag with you?
It's just some overnight things, you know? Just in case inspiration strikes.
Oh, come on, Alistair. We agreed on no horror story stuff tonight.
Relax. I always carry this thing with me, okay? I'm not going to be doing any work tonight. It's just in case.
Hey, beautiful.
So, this is your friend.
Yeah, hi.
Hi. He sure does look familiar.
Hell yeah. My man Alistair, he's a famous writer.
Oh, yeah.
Come on in.
Wow. Hey, wasn't your cousin supposed to be here? Whoa, she knows her thing.
Any one of you feel like a smoke?
Ah, no, thank you. I've had enough for today. I can't keep smoking like this with the upcoming season right around the corner.
You smoke?
Sure, why not? Yeah, you guys go. I'll get to know the cousin.
Red Goblins? My boyfriend, or ex-boyfriend, always smoked these.
Right.
We're getting one.
So, why did you guys break up?
Oh, he got weird and jealous when I started hanging out with Mickey, his friend. But that's sort of what this whole Monica situation is about. Mickey is her brother. He's sort of missing right now. Speaking of breaking up, did you know that your friend in there broke up with his last girlfriend because of the way she chewed her food?
No, I didn't know that.
Hey, you must be Monica.
Alistair Burnham?
Yeah?
Officer Cindy Perkins, this is Professor Andrei Ashtakov.
I have a plane to catch, so...
You'll have to wait, I'm sorry, Mr. Burnham.
We just broadcast locally, you know, so... Fuck, it's Renard. He's been calling me all day.
Aren't you going to answer it?
Nope.
You were talking about broadcast?
Yeah, we just broadcast local radio, you know, so so around here, like, my demographic, they know me quite well. Fuck.
What?
It's a text from Renard. See, I fucking knew it. Trying to use the situation to get close to me. Fucking creep. Wait. Pose for this.
What? What? Oh.
Yeah, no, of course I get it. I mean, you don't have to talk to me if you don't wanna. But, I mean, let's face it, he's been missing for one day. I'm sure he's fine. And besides, you know what always works for me when I'm in a weird mood? Shrimp pizza. Yo, Alistair! Where are you going?
Who was that?
That's Alistair.
What?
Hey. Bernard's on his way here.
What? Why?
He just sent me this really weird text.
So, what you're saying is there's some sort of psycho out there who's stalking me wherever I go? That's ridiculous. I mean, this is obviously some sort of coincidence. I mean, I travel a lot. It's the most important part of my job.
Harold Wolmer is a very dangerous man, a very deranged mind who must be found before it's too late.
What exactly is wrong with this guy?
He's suffering from what we at the institution refers to as a DPD, a denied personality disorder, an aggressive form of schizophrenic self-loathing. For some reason, Harold Wolmer hates himself so much. He only reflects his own true self in those he chooses to harm. But for some reason, he has now chosen a pattern that won't shift. Almost like he would have found a personality he doesn't want to leave. And you, Mr. Burnham, just so happened to fit into that pattern.
So what? He thinks he's me?
Most likely he wants to be you.
Why'd you let him out?
We didn't. He escaped 8 months ago and has been on the run ever since.
8 months?
What is that?
Oh, that is...
It's writing for itself. It has to be some kind of evil spirit.
No, it's not. It's God.
Obviously, somebody hacked into his laptop.
What?
We need to trace this user before he gets offline.
Hacking into a computer? Isn't that something? Do you have any idea who might be doing it?
Alistair.
I don't remember what they looked like. Really?
But if I have to, I'd say Renard, which is a weird fucking name anyway. He looked like the average Joe. So I guess his name should be Joe. But the other one, the troll with the gross long hair, he was huge. The biggest person I've ever seen, hands down.
Thank you.
You know, hadn't it been for Karen going all Inception girlfriend on my ass, I might even remember their stupid faces better. But you know, average, boring looking people. Mundane.
Oh, but he was big.
Or really small. I say big.
Renard, what the fuck is this?
Where is he?
Alistair, I still can't need to go.
Jesus, you scared me. What is it? What is it?
How long have we known this guy?
Alistair? For 2 weeks. He's a passing traveler, I told you. Why?
Okay, look at this.
That's not Alistair.
Alistair Burnham, the writer, this is what he looks like, numbnuts. The loser in there is someone else.
Alistair! Come on, Alistair, I need to go too. Alistair.
Hey, where are you guys going?
Fuck out of here, what do you think?
Okay, Lonnie, come on, let's just go now, please.
All right. Thanks, Frank. It's not even 10 minutes from here. Let's go.
Did you get a bit of writing done in there, or?
Where are the others?
They left.
They left?
They said you're not really Alistair.
And who did they say I was?
Said your name is Harold.
Harold Vollmer. Right. Do you want to know what makes a good story, Danny? Simply writing about your own experiences, searching for the answers in real life. Look, if you want to write about love, you must have felt love. And if you want to write about, say, politics, you need to understand politics. So if you want to write about death, Danny, you must really know death. I've traveled for quite some time now. You know, I've seen people's reactions as they witness death for the first time. The thing is, I live my stories, Danny. So who's Harold Vollmer? To me, he's just a sick, confused man who spent years locked up, reading each and every one of Alistair Burnham's stories. Until one day, Alistair Burnham, the writer, he simply stopped writing. Harold Vollmer did what Alistair Burnham never could have done on his own. He gave his stories their life back. Do you want to know what Alistair Burnham's next story is about?
What is it about?
It's about a young, tattooed, racist gang leader whose girlfriend is unfaithful to him with one of his closest.
Look, she's a good friend of Monica's and she was having a tough time. You weren't reachable as usual, so she reached out to me. It's all that happened, I swear on my life.
I don't remember what they looked like. Really, I don't. I was Alistair. Besides, I was far away in the bushes, hiding, you know, at least for a while.
Oh, you must have quite an impressive set of testicles sneaking up on me like this. Are you just ignorant?
If I come out, are you gonna shoot me?
Oh, you're the one standing in darkness.
I'm all lit up.
You can see I'm nowhere near grabbing my gun.
But at least you know where you are. And that's good to know.
Oh no, don't. Jeez. Yeah.
I was trying to tell you.
Is he all right?
Oh no. But he's not supposed to be either.
What's your name, Bigfoot? Alistair. Alistair Burnham.
Well, Alistair Burnham. You smoke?
Yeah? Sure. Thanks.
So does this man here. It's a filthy habit. Since this will be his last smoke, why don't you take the rest of these? I myself am an armed smoker. See, I promised to fulfill a final wish for this little man. Wouldn't be a shame to waste the rest of these since I had to buy a whole pack. Enjoy that shit wipe. And just know, I will stand by what I said about her.
It's gonna happen.
What did he do?
Oh, he... he should be able to tell you just as well. Right, Mickey?
Mickey is her brother. He's sort of missing right now.
Now, Alistair, was it? Why don't you let me give you something to write about?
No!
So you know what he does? You know what he should do? He should take justice into his own hands.
Holy Harold, chill!
I call it Sledgehammer Clansman.
I'm gonna take this.
Looks like he won't be breaking in anymore. You're welcome. honestly don't remember much more. Okay, fine. I remember the ending. So, after all the Karen-looking idiots had left, you know, with the two morons, I guess somebody must have called the cops. But you know, Danny got me out of there before that escalated. He was, well, pissed that I butchered that little hockey kid. But you know, I bet he laughs just thinking about it by now.
You two stay here. There's nobody in there.
What?
What is that?
It's a sledgehammer, I suppose.
The sledgehammer, from my story.
With all due respect, Mr. Burnham, this was never your story.
I was a fan of horror stories. I told you this.
You see, I myself am not a big fan of horror stories. I prefer comedies.
There was this one masterpiece, though. I told you this as well. This one film that got to me.
It was about this cannibal, and he was traveling all over the place. he was trying to find people he could eat.
Anyway, there was this scene where this cannibal guy. Well, he tied up this other guy to a tree. He strapped the rope to his horse. Oh, God. You know what? I don't feel like talking about it.
Happy Halloween. Punky Pumpkin's a happy pumpkin. And do you know why? 'Cause he's a jack-o'-lantern instead of being a pumpkin pie. Yes, he's a jack-o'-lantern instead of being a pumpkin pie. Smiling pumpkin, grinning happily. You can count his teeth, 'cause he has only three. Punky Pumpkin, the winking pumpkin, blinks his eye at you. For his favorite game is playing peek-a-boo. His birthday is on Halloween, so that's a special date. For all the other jack-o'-lanterns to get together and celebrate. Punky Pumpkin's a happy pumpkin, and do you know why? 'Cause he's a jack-o'-lantern instead of being.